I've been asked to speak about the addressing social problems or pressures at Mount Kinabalu. Social pressures, what are the pressures? I can think of only two, the surrounding communities, Kinabalu being a sacred mountain to us, and then the indigenous people surrounding it, boundary issues, and secondly, tourism or the climbing issues. Kinabalu is a World Heritage since December 2000, and is one of the richest biodiversity in the world per unit area. But I won't talk about that today. That's a story for another time. Kinabalu Park was gazetted in 1964. This is the area, and the highest peak is slightly more than 4,000. It's about the height of Mount Cook. In 1969, it was like this. Just to give you the orientation, we are here. Malaysia consists of this West Malaysia and East Malaysia, Sarawak and Sabah. So we are here. The community surrounding the park area, I'm one of them. That's Mount Kinabalu and the people around. That's the park boundary, and it's surrounded by people. That's the major peak, and you access it from here. On the 2nd of December 2000, it was designated a World Heritage status. And the people around, including myself, I am from a village somewhere here. We were very happy, we were very proud. The people, especially around the operation, the mountain climbing, was very proud, very happy. Fast forward 10 years. In year 2000, I went around and had some discussion, some dialogue with the villagers. They're very unhappy. They said, we no longer want to be a World Heritage. I said, why? It's a major recognition. They said, there are just so many people going climbing, visiting and climbing. Not only is a major cause for congestion, road congestion, the prices of goods has become expensive, and the accommodation has become full all the time, and there's no opportunity for them to climb the mountain. It's supposed to be a sacred site, and they said, when they agreed in 1964 to designate that as a park, they said, you know, with the understanding that they'll be able to access their sacred site. But since it has become a World Heritage, it's just so full all the time and so expensive for them. They just cannot afford it. They said they no longer want it to be a World Heritage. They said it's actually not our decision. But since then, I have initiated what I call a community day, community engagement day. The reason being, there are three ideas that changed my outlook on managing our parks. One is the World Park Congress in Durban, South Africa. They keep on pumping into our head benefit beyond boundaries. Secondly, in a Congress of Ethnobiology in Canada, they keep talking about reconnecting people with their sacred mountains inside the parks. Since 1964 to 2010, people have been disconnected from the park, from the sacred sites. And thirdly, I had the opportunity to visit Tongariro and the Maori and their lands and the mountains, and it totally changed my outlook. And came back to Borneo and said, these three things should be the way forward. And so the people, this is Mount Kinabalu, the park boundary is somewhere there, and people like this village surrounds the Kinabalu. And what I did was we initiated the Kinabalu Community Day on 2nd December, which is the birthday of the park, as well as the significant because that's the date for the World Heritage designation. We started in 2010 to strengthen our relationship. Free climb for all communities, maximum of 150 pax for that day and the next day, and community bazaar inside the park. It's very successful, and every year we have it now. If you come around this time, it will be a community day, and people will be like myself in this costume. And also we started the Kinabalu Council of Elders to advise us on matters, customs, and native customary rights, etc. That's my chairman, and it's This is our tribal costume. And the Manila, in the early days, when people go up the mountain, they sacrifice chicken and other offerings. So we resurrected that. We started that again. And it has become a major tourist attraction also. We also started, we initiated this e-calling project because apart from Kinabalu Park, there's a sister park just a few kilometers, something like 30 kilometers south. And we started the e-calling project as a wildlife corridor between these two parks. And we talked with the villagers of the promoting community conserved areas. We tell them that we are not going to gazette any new areas, but we promote them, designating their own conserved areas, especially those areas that needed for water catchment. Very successful. That's about the community issue. Boundary issues, we have some issues also. For example, this was 2 weeks ago. The park is here, and that's the orchard, newly. And there are some overlapping areas that are claimed by the villagers as their native customary right. It's quite easy to, it's a difficult issue, but not difficult to talk to them because I'm one of them, we are one of them. And also these are the, this one such villagers that have overlapping claims to the park. And our solution is, for example, in our Croco Range Park, we designated what we call a community use zone inside the park. Though they won't get the title, it's still a park, but they are free to use the designated community use zone. So that's our way forward for that. Now, the second part, which is the thing I want to talk today, the tourism part, the climbers. Before the earthquake, we allow 220 climbers a day. But after the earthquake, we limit to 135. The Kinabalu earthquake, that happened on the 5th of June, 2015. Kinabalu is actually 19 kilometers long with 12 major peaks. Lowest peak, you cannot see it, but it's somewhere there. That's the height. And on normal day, that's the highest peak, lowest peak. Those are the climbers that goes up. Climbers again. Climbing Mount Kinabalu, we have been managing the mountain since 1964. But our detailed record only started in 1993. And of those, almost a million climbers since. Fatalities, 22, which give you a percentage of very small. But then climbing Kinabalu, you start at 6,000 meters above sea level. This is 2,000 meters above sea level. That's the starting point. And normally, it will take about 6 hours to reach the mountain huts. Spend the day, spend the night there, wake up at 2 a.m., and by 2:30, you make it to the summit, and then come back the second day. We'll be back by midday. So 2 days operation. On the 5th of June at 7:15, Kinabalu earthquake, which is 6 on the Richter scale, smaller than the Christchurch earthquake, but it was devastating nonetheless. And that's the major rockfall from here. And that's this is the mountain huts, and that is the summit trail. And it went right here. And during that day, 60-plus people were on these mountain huts, another 137 here, and fatalities was here as well as here. And so 18 people lost their lives on that day because that rock fall happened on the climbing trail. Like I said, 137 people were stranded up on the mountain on that day, like this. The rockfall came this way. Remember, that's the summit trail. Whatever is preventing the climbers on the summit area from coming down is also preventing the search and rescue people, personnel, to go up and rescue them. So they were there for the whole day, fortunately. And helicopter cannot land, not only because of the altitude, but it was windy that day and foggy. And so fortunately, by the end of the day, before dark, the mountain guides as well as our rangers managed to get everybody down safely. That's the search and rescue operation for the 5 days. And some heroic efforts by mountain guides as well as members of the mountain huts, bringing tourist climbers down. And so a total of 277 people were on the summit on that day. Those are the climbers, the mountain guides. And sadly, 18 people lost their lives, including 4 mountain guides. And immediately after the search and rescue operation was called off, after 5 days, I went up on the 10th of June and with my park ranger, park manager and senior park ranger. The 3 of us went up to assess the damage, and one hut, mountain hut, was totally damaged, Panalaban. And there's the major damage areas around here. There's the source of the rockfall. There's the mountain hut. Fortunately, it went here and then diverted this way. There's the extent of, this was the summit trail. Summit trail goes right here. And for scale, and again, some of the boulders, loose boulders, and for scale, that's my park manager. And also, those are the mountain huts, the loose rocks, for scale, and it went this way, straight to the mountain huts, but then diverted after. That's the used to be the mountain trail. That's the mountain hut there. And one of the major damage, the donkey's ear, one of the lobe, fall off. Fortunately, to the other side, not to the mountain huts. And I just want to show, not us, but that is no longer there. That's the one. It's no longer there. So when I went up on the 5th day, not much damage up there, beyond 3,500. External and local helps after the earthquake, I sent out SOS, and many people responded, including Dave Bamford, who gave me useful pointers. And the Global Park volunteers from Canada came without any consultancy fees. And the Japan Association of Mountain Guides also came, fully sponsored by JICA, and local expert, and of course our local technical committee. So resulting in our plan, there's some members of the Japan Mountain Guide Association. We did some survey to assess the damage and what to do next, the possible routes, new routes. And so it was concluded to establish two new trails, Ranau Trail and Kota Blue Trail, and construct rockfall barriers and boulder stabilization system. Not easy up there, and the implementation will be in 3 phases. So this is the mountain hut. Remember, this was the old summit trail. So Ranau Trail, near brand new, and then an alternative Kota Blue Trail. This is open now, completed and open. This is 90% complete and going to be open soon. So our team, the park staff, mountain guides, and villagers, restoration team, this was what we did. And then the first phase of the opening, our committee. This is nice because it happened, we first opened it on the 8th of August, 8 at 8 a.m. with 88 climbers. Actually, there are a lot more than that, but we like the number. So this is our restoration work for the Ranau Trail. And all the remember, all this material need to be taken by hand up there on foot. And we constructed the trail, including the boulders, the loose rocks, and the brand new trail. We cut a new trail, including this one. This is no longer there because we thought that this is better. Many people objected to this when we for the trail opening. And so this is how it's now. This is the Kota Blue, the second trail, more challenging. And we opened on the 1st of December, 179 days after the earthquake. But now, instead of 220, we only allow 135. And the Via Ferrata has also been reopened to the public, the Via Ferrata way. And we work together with the MOSAR, Mountain Search and Rescue people. And we also upgraded our standard operating procedures for mountain guides. And we recently conducted our search and rescue simulation. Next, we are going to construct the rockfall barrier system. It's in tendering process now. I don't understand this, but just to impress you. That's currently our trail up the mountain, the alternative trail, and the rockfall barrier system that we are going to install. There are some positive also. After the earthquake, we are going to build a mountain hut complex, new one, at the same area, and consisting of hostel and staff quarters, as well as sick bay, etc. It has started work. I think it's 8% completion now. And another positive is the sewerage system has been a sore issue for us for many years, because in mountain areas, the sewerage is such a headache for me. But after the, we have been applying to the federal government, but the fund was not forthcoming. After the earthquake, I quickly said, oh, all our sewerage system are broken. It need to be fixed. Actually, it had been broken for a long time. So they gave us the money, about 1.5 million New Zealand dollars. It's about 5 million Malaysian ringgit. And it's tendering process now. They are going to select the successful tenderer, and hopefully in 16 months' time, it will be operational. And that will be the site for the centralized sewerage treatment plant. So the Kinabalu Restoration Project, I'd like to say it's a labor of love from the park staff, mountain guides, and villagers. Some people did not like this. But we have an alternative. The second trail, Kota Blue Trail, is much, much more challenging, just using ropes. So if you don't like this, you can go the other side. And these are all done by our staff. And all, each single one of those are carried up. It's 6-7 kilometers. And with an elevation gain of some 2,000 meters. After the earthquake, before starting the restoration process, we promised the people, the government, and the people of the world, World Heritage Site, we said, Kinabalu will be back better than before. And we are back. Kinabalu is back better than before. Thank you.